Dr. Doug Tallamy teaches entomology, among other things, at the University of Delaware, and is really the person who I believe launched a massive movement to help all of us learn about the importance of using native plants in our backyard landscaping, around our businesses, our churches, all around our schoolyards, in the effort to increase insects. And we're going to learn a lot more about that with Doug, if it's okay for me to call you Doug.
Please,
okay,
yes,
that's
yes.
Great.
And we're going to do it in the front yard too.
And the front yard, absolutely, front and back and side, right? All of it.
Yeah.
Well, you are here actually at the University of Notre Dame, where you're going to speak here in a little bit. And I do want to just give a quick acknowledgement. There were several groups that helped get you here today. So I'm going to give a shout out to Wild Ones South Bend, South Bend Elkhart Audubon, Indiana Native Plant Society, North Chapter, and the Environmental Change Initiative, which is right here at University of Notre Dame. So we are sitting actually in kind of a nice shady spot with some natives, right? Mm-hmm. And we're at the Sculpture Garden outside of the Art Museum at the University of Notre Dame. And surrounding us are a number of oak trees. And I have to say, one of my favorite books of yours, of which you've written several, is The Nature of Oaks. Why do you love oaks?
I grew up loving white oaks because they were fun trees to climb. Then I learned, hey, they were really important plants. There are four ecological goals that every landscape has. They have to sequester carbon. They have to manage the watershed that they're in. They have to support a food web, and they have to support pollinators. Oaks do all of that. People say, wait a minute, they're wind pollinated.
Yeah.
It's true, but the catkins hang down in the spring and a number of bees go and gather up that pollen anyway, even though they're not actually pollinating with it. They're using it to rear their young. Not only do oaks do those things, they do them better than other plants. So they're the very best choice for sequestering carbon because they're so huge and they live a long time.
Yeah.
They've got big root systems, so they're great at managing the watershed. They are by far the best tree for supporting the food web because they support the most caterpillars, and caterpillars are the bread and butter of terrestrial food webs.
Right, especially birds, my favorite birds. Yep.
Especially birds.
Yep.
96% of our birds rear their young on insects, and most of those insects are caterpillars. So where do they come from? They come from trees like oaks.
Now, you did a really interesting thing, I think, in your yard where you looked at oak leaves, oak branches at eye level, and you literally counted caterpillars, right?
Right.
What'd you find?
A lot of caterpillars.
Yeah, a lot of caterpillars, right.
This was a tree I planted as an acorn, and then, you know, it grew. And the significance of that is, by putting that acorn in the ground, having the tree grow, it's you're kind of acting like God. You're bringing a whole bunch of life to your yard. And I just wanted to demonstrate what was using that tree. And I walked around, and at eye level, I counted 410 caterpillars.
Wow, that's a lot.
And then I stood back and took a picture of the tree to demonstrate you don't see any of those caterpillars. And you don't see the caterpillar damage, which is what people worry about. But if I knocked on your door and said, you've got 410 caterpillars just on the lower branches, call the man, get the spray can, save the tree. All of that is totally unnecessary. And because that oak is supporting so many caterpillars, I've got breeding birds in our yard. The latest count is 62 species of birds that have bred on our property because we put plants like that oak in.
Okay, nice. In contrast, something like a burning bush or another non-native tree, what would you find like for caterpillars in something like that?
Yeah, well, the same day I did go to my neighbor's burning bush and we tried to count the same amount of plant biomass.
Okay.
I got four caterpillars.
Four caterpillars.
Not 410, four. It was all one species. They're tiny little micros. So it's not enough to support a food web.
And the reason, as I understand it, is because the insects that are indigenous to our habitats did not co-evolve with plants that came from other continents, right? So they can't eat those other plants.
Right. That period of coevolution is very important because plants don't want to be eaten, and they're all protecting themselves in several ways, but particularly phytochemistry. They put nasty chemicals in their leaves, which makes them distasteful. Well, an insect just can't walk up to a plant and start to eat it. It has to have the adaptations to get past those nasties. And the monarch butterfly is a perfect example, because milkweeds are toxic plants. They're filled with cardiac glycosides, and they've got sticky latex sap that give them their common name. The monarch can eat milkweeds because it's got the physiological adaptations to get around the cardiac glycosides and the behavioral adaptations to block the flow of that sticky latex sap. It's specialized on milkweeds. And that's the upside of specialization. They can eat a plant that most other insects can't eat. The downside is that's all they can eat.
Right.
So if we take milkweeds out of our landscapes,
yep,
there goes the monarch. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what we've done.
Okay. So one quick fun fact, because I do love birds and I do love oak trees. And look, it's not a great year for oak acorns. Look at this tiny, this one's not going to make it, right? That's like a half-formed acorn. But blue jays eat acorns, and they carry them all around. You have a fun fact about the number of acorns a blue jay
blue jays hurts. Are the primary disperser of oak acorns. And they will pick up an acorn and fly a mile or a mile and a half from the tree, tap it below the surface of the soil. And the object is they're going to go back in the wintertime and have something to eat. But for every four acorns a blue jay buries, it only remembers where one is. So for every four acorns they bury, they've actually planted three oak trees. And a single jay buries a lot of acorns, about 4,500 every year.
Yay,
and there's a lot
jays.
Of jays around. So.
Yeah.
Jays have allowed oaks to move, to disperse farther and faster than any other deciduous tree in the world.
But good reminder, if we only have space or the interest or the ability to plant one tree in our yard, you would advocate for a native oak.
I would, depending on where you live.
Okay.
In 84% of the counties in which they occur, they're the number one. We call them keystone plants because they're adding the most energy to local food webs. So that would be my choice. Now, as you move around the country, you want to pick the right species of oaks, because we've got 91 species of oaks.
Yeah.
And in the Southwest, they're very different from in Indiana. And in the Pacific Northwest, there's only one species, the Oregon oak. And in Idaho, there's none. So you want to be in the
good
right
point.
Place.
Good point, yep.
But
yep.
Generally speaking, where most people live, oaks are it.
Okay. Now, if we think about people's yards, and maybe they can put it in an oak, great, but there's usually a lot of grass, a lot of lawn, right?
Yeah.
That doesn't really support much of anything. It's a monoculture. Well, in my yard, it's not really a monoculture because it's got all kinds of stuff growing. But tell us your philosophy about lawns and what we can do about them.
Well, I'll give you some fun facts.
Okay, great.
Not a philosophy, just some facts.
Yep.
We've got about 44 million acres of lawn in this country, which is an area bigger than all of New England. It's dedicated to an ecological deadscape. Remember those four things?
Yeah.
Sequester carbon, support a food web, manage the watershed, and support pollinators. Lawn does none of those. So we people with a lot of lawn have failed in the ecological responsibilities that their yard has. So it's a status symbol. It's a perfect plant to walk on, so wherever we walk, lawn is appropriate. But we can cut that area down. I don't recommend getting rid of lawn because we call it a cue for care. We want to develop landscapes that fit into our current culture. And if you have some lawn and it is manicured, it is mowed, you don't have to put the fertilizer and the insecticides and the herbicides and everything else
right.
on it.
Right.
It can still look nice. Then you're part of the culture. Your neighborhood doesn't throw you out. You just have more plants.
Yeah.
But right. it's still neat.
And they do, I mean, because of the care they take, as you mentioned, many people, not everybody, but many people use chemicals. We're mowing them frequently, and that's putting a lot of carbon into the air, right?
Yeah. So I mentioned lawn is not sequestering carbon. It's the worst plant for that. It's adding it because and lawnmowers are the dirtiest two-cycle engines we have.
Yeah.
So, it's a big neighbor.
And it uses a lot of water.
In most places, there are very few places in the country where you can have a nice green lawn all year without watering. So it turns out that lawn is the largest irrigated crop in the country.
That's amazing.
And this is water we don't have.
Yeah.
We're in a very dry period right now. People are watering their lawns. And this is why California, for example, has a $3 per square foot rebate. Every square foot of lawn you remove, you get $3 and replace with a xeric landscape. They don't have the water.
Xeric meaning low water landscape, right?
Yeah.
Lower.
Desert adapted. Desert. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I thought we could walk around here a little bit because here in the sculpture garden, we do have some native plants. We can kind of maybe head over this way.
Okay.
And we can talk a little bit about some of the natives that are here, but also maybe you can help folks understand what are some keystone species that folks might like to put in their yard, and how does that work?
Okay, you know, keystone is a functional term. I talk about keystone plants in terms of the ones that support the most caterpillars, and as I said, oaks are the best. Native cherries are very high. Native willows are very high. There's native willows across the way.
Oh, yeah.
There.
Over there, yeah.
They support about 450 species of caterpillars. But you can also talk about keystone plants for pollinators, the ones that are supporting the most specialist pollinators. If you plant for specialist pollinators, the generalists come too. And by generalists, I mean they can use a lot of different plants, so things like honeybees and bumblebees. But we've got 3,600 to 4,000 species of native bees. A third of them are specialists. If you don't have the plant they specialize on, you've lost that bee. But the plants you'd pick for a pollinator garden, the keystone plants you pick for a pollinator garden, are going to be different from the ones you'd pick for caterpillar production.
Okay.
Sometimes.
Okay.
The very best plant for depends on where you are. Around here, the very best plant for specialist pollinators would be one of the sunflowers, the helianthus. But the second would be one of the goldenrods. Goldenrods support 110 species of caterpillars.
Yeah.
So they do both. That's a great addition. And then a whole bunch of plants that support fewer.
Okay. And here kind of around us, I see some boneset, right? That's a nice native. We've got some grasses.
Yeah. There's a really interesting story about boneset.
Yeah.
With monarchs, if you have time for it. But
yeah.
They produce a compound called pyrrolizidine alkaloids.
Okay.
It's toxic. Nobody wants pyrrolizidine alkaloids. And notice, it's not being eaten.
Right.
Monarchs will stop, and if there's a crushed leaf or a damaged leaf, they will try to suck up pyrrolizidine alkaloids. They're there specifically to eat this toxin.
Wow.
That's called pharmacophagy.
Oh, I love that word.
They have left their host plant, milkweed, in order to get a toxic substance. Why did they do that? Well, they do that because the males sequester it, and they actually pass it to the females when they mate. And it protects them, makes them taste bad. Monarchs already taste bad, but it's another level, right? Well, it's a nuptial gift. The female likes males with a lot of pyrrolizidine.
Oh,
when she lays
cool.
her eggs, it protects them
from getting eaten.
Okay. 90% of monarch eggs are eaten by ants before they even hatch.
So you
might see, and that they're not the only things that go after pyrrolizidine alkaloids.
Yeah.
They're insects that are going out to eat toxic plants all the time. Very strange.
And I just want to circle back too, because you know we've got this kind of mostly native landscape, and you know you don't really see evidence of them being eaten, but we plant native plants to attract insects, so we should not be alarmed when we see a few holes in our beautiful natives, right? They're doing their job.
You should be alarmed if you don't see them. Because look at your crepe myrtle, look at your ginkgo, look at your burning bush. There are no holes, which means it's a decoration. I like to think of them as statues.
I know, plastic statues.
They're just there. They're not doing anything,
right.
Except the ones I just mentioned. You know, well, not crepe myrtle, but burning bush, porcelain berry. You know, we get serious Bradford pear, Callery pear, serious invasive species. Not only do they not support the food web, they escape our yards, and they biologically pollute the landscape around us. So we have parks and preserves. About a third of the vegetation in these parks and preserves are plants from Asia that have escaped from our gardens, and they're not supporting the local food web.
And folks know, as a former director of a county park system, we spent a lot of time and resources trying to get rid of things that have escaped people's gardens, like barberry and Callery pear, etc. So it is
and
it's a problem.
Yet we're still selling them in our
nursery.
So, you know,
there's
a logical disconnect here.
There is. All right. Well, I do want to just mention there are several great books that Dr. Tallamy has authored The Nature of Oaks, Nature's Best Hope, Bringing Nature Home, The Living Landscape, Designing for Beauty and Biodiversity, and you have a new book coming out in January 2025. What is that?
Actually, it's going to be the end of March now.
Oh,
they keep
pushing it back.
Pushing it
okay,
back.
Okay, in 2025, yeah. What will that be?
It's called How Can I Help? And what it really is, it answers 499 questions I have gotten from
over
people.
Over and over, probably, yeah.
I get them over and over, yeah, and from on email. And I typed these big, long answers. I said, this is taking an enormous amount of time. So I started saving them.
Oh, good, right.
And they're in there. Yep. So these are questions that people who've heard me talk and read the books, mm-hmm. they still have good questions.
Sure, sure.
You know, we'll see. I don't know if it's going to work, but it's coming out.
Sounds great. Yeah. And so two last questions for you. Back in the 1990s when I first started using native plants, you couldn't buy them anywhere. It was really hard to buy them, and not many people were interested at all. But again, you have helped launch a movement. So what do you attribute the enthusiasm, the growing enthusiasm to?
People like nature, yeah. And they're hearing, they're seeing the headlines. We've lost 3 billion breeding birds. The UN says we're going to lose 1 million species to extinction. We've lost 2/3 of Earth's wildlife already. People don't like that. My message is simple. You can help put it back, and you can help put it back right in your yard, and it's not that hard.
Yeah.
So that's, you know, hearing that is what is getting people excited. They can, you know, we're talking about millions of people. That is an army of conservationists that can help turn this around. In a fun way.
In a fun way.
Yeah.
Yeah. And those of us who enjoy plants and birds and wildlife, it's something relatively easy that we can do. Okay, last question. You travel a lot. You give lots of presentations. You do online presentations. You were in Cleveland last night. Now you're here at Notre Dame. You are advocating all the time. What keeps you going? What motivates you?
You know that book, Nature's Best Hope?
Yeah.
It's my audiences that are nature's best hope. They come. Last night the room was packed. That motivates me. Okay. These people want to hear this. They're enthusiastic. I do see the needle moving. So interest is what motivates me. I wrote Bringing Nature High. I didn't think anybody would read it.
Yeah.
Well, they did. You know, people say it changed my life. Well, it changed my life
for
too,
sure.
You know,
yeah.
But in a positive way. So that's, you know, that,
seeing
that keeps me going.
Seeing the enthusiasm and people getting interested.
There's urgency to this. We really need to turn this around. And that's, you know, when I hear people respond, that's what keeps me going.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
Well, think about planting an oak, native plants in your front yard or backyard, wherever you can, because it can make a difference. And remember, you can find your own outdoor elements when you visit area parks and natural areas. We'll see you soon.